Welcome to Nay Duniya once again.
Thank you.
I think the whole world at the moment is focused on happiness. Of course, everybody would like the world to be happier, but it seems that in the globalized world, we are in the pursuit of materialism and we think that money gives us the most happiness. So people are working very long hours at the cost of their family and at their own, at the cost of their own health. As well as, I think to some extent, as per the research and reports, individualism is leading to selfishness and unconcern for others. And if we look at the whole scenario, we find most people are not happy. So in this episode, it would be nice to discuss what is the Baha'i view of happiness. Are there some clues how one can individually lead a happy life and how can we socially become a happier world?
You know, your subject is a very interesting one because everybody is looking for happiness and everybody's idea of happiness is strangely different. Some people are confusing it with pleasure, some are confusing it with contentment, some say that no, happiness is something that is very difficult to get, so we should enjoy, and they think that this concept of enjoy is equal to happiness.
What is the meaning of enjoy or enjoyment? That is parties and dancing is very present
yes.
now, and drinking and drugs even. I mean, we
just
saw in Uttar Punjab, the whole state is full of drugs, it seems. We are not commenting on the state as such, but that's what is being talked about.
No, I was just reading recently, and one of the interesting things that came up was the concept of our brain. And what it's put down over there was that there are three different levels that have happened. And with evolution, the basic brain is still the same. But more and more is being added on top of it. And this more and more that is being added on top of it is your cerebral cortex, which gives you the ability to think, to relate, to do all the things that we require today to survive in the modern society. And the basic brain which is there was actually made for primitive man, and so it reacts in the same way.
So with the evolution in technology and in cosmetology and other sciences, don't we feel that as a doctor, don't you say that the brain of man also has evolved to some extent?
Yes, but it has been an add-on. You see, it's like if you give an example,
the size of the brain becoming bigger and we are becoming
true.
More intelligent and so
correct.
On.
Correct, it's an add-on. But the basic levels have remained the same. It's like saying that you've been given a wooden robot and now you're going to convert it into the most latest technology, but you still have the robot. And whatever is being added on now is added on to that robot to make it go faster.
So I think that's why we mourn the loss of contact with nature.
Correct.
We have the wonderful offices which are completely air conditioned, the 5-star hotels where people go to enjoy and have meals, and we are all the time looking at our mobile phones and doing text messaging or making calls or Facebook and thinking this gives us happiness and this is the way we spend our leisure. But it has reduced the outdoor activities and so we are not really able to focus and concentrate even on anything that we are doing. And the contact between human beings has become very weak, even in the families. People are on their mobiles and doing all that, whereas they should be talking to each other or discussing the progress of the family or the family matters some problems that they face. So the isolation that we were talking about, I think, is increasing.
That's very true. On the other hand, what we've basically lost is our harmony with the whole of creation. Mm-hmm. And because we have lost that harmony, we are not content, or we are not really happy. We may be content with it, oh, we've got a new car, we've got a new house, we've got a good family relationship, I've got everything in life.
But what is that good? It reminds me of the quote from the Gita that materialism cannot give you happiness. Love for material things, and Abdul Baha, the beloved master of the Baha'i faith, also says material things often give us suffering, not happiness. So the true happiness can only be found in a deeper sense of spirituality.
See, now this is the point that people are not willing to accept. And till they come to that realization that man is essentially a spiritual being, they are not going to accept this fact that happiness comes from spirituality. So-called contentment or happiness or pleasure or joy or whatever we are getting is all temporary.
Momentary.
So let's start with a simple understanding taken from the Baha'i history. When Baha'u'llah, the founder of the Baha'i faith, was wrongfully put in prison in the Siachar,
The dark prison.
Which was basically a pit with all the murderers and some of the Babis there. And every day the jailer would come, he would call out a few names, and they would take those Babis out and they would martyr them. Now in such a situation, what is the mindset that you would expect from a person? Despair?
That's true.
Frustration?
The highest level.
Hopelessness?
Yes.
Yet what was the state over there? It was one of joy. So this is essentially a lesson to us that our physical surroundings, our material condition is not the cause of our happiness. Now once we understand this basic concept, then we realize that if God has created man, has given man certain functions, has given him a capacity, and has added on to his basic brain. Now the basic brain reacted on emotion. It reacted on self-preservation. Now today, if we go on the road, we are suddenly confronted with a crisis, or what we call a crisis, of somebody misbehaving on the road, of somebody cutting in front of you. What is your reaction? It is that same basic reaction of self-preservation. Now, unless that is controlled by the higher centers, which are, you might call the new brain.
That's true. We are in that process of evolution and realization. I think what you have brought up beautifully is that man is not only body, it is body plus. That is, the reality of man is the human soul. And this body is fleeting and temporary, and the whole material world is temporary. And whatever we think of these gadgets or the homes or the food or the parties, they're all momentary pleasure. They're not the real lasting joy. And I think I was going to talk about you continued about Dr. Abdul Kalam, who came to Lotus Temple, Baha'i House of Worship. And when we met him, he talked about the essential need for science and spirituality in the modern era. And he has written so many books on that. So this spirituality has to be defined, the science has to be defined. and how this science and spirituality, or in the terms of the Baha'i faith, religion, because our concept of religion is not ritualistic, it is not priests, it is one journey towards God. So Dr. Kalam told me, he said, if that is your belief, and we call it a faith, not even religion, he says, that is what is spirituality, that how do we become better and better every day, how do we acquire virtues, how do we become God conscious, how do we work for an ever advancing civilization. These are the things that can give humanity happiness, and also the person who is committed to these ideals.
So let's now take up one aspect, because you see, spirituality covers the whole of creation. It covers every single aspect of our life. So let's take up one thing. And because the Baha'i Faith is a religion which claims that it has fulfilled all the prophecies of all the religions of the past, it stands to logic that all those religions were the foundation. And on that foundation only can the Baha'i Faith stand. Now naturally, when you are in, say, a lower class, things are explained to you in detail.
With parables, with metaphors.
With stories, metaphors, pictures, in so many ways.
Correct.
And once you come to a higher level, it is just stated as a simple statement.
More philosophical and abstract, maybe.
And you have to assume that you already have the knowledge of that foundation.
That's right.
So let's start with that foundation on a very simple concept, and that is karma. And then we will realize how karma is the cause of spiritual happiness.
That's a very deep and perhaps controversial word, karma, in the right sense, perhaps, as you would explain, hopefully later on, it would be very meaningful. But in the simplistic interpretation of karma, we talk about life and many births. And
no, we are not going into that.
Correct.
We are going right now into our actions.
Okay. The present day actions.
Yes, our present day actions. And what effect it has and what it is.
That is what I think Baha'i writing talk about in the term is goodly deeds.
That's one of the expressions of
question.
So let's start with a basic thing. Now the Bhagavad Gita tells us that karma is tamasic.
Yes.
And now tamasic refers to ignorance.
Demonic, is it?
It refers to ignorance,
mm-hmm.
It refers to laziness,
okay,
and it refers to demonic in the sense of knowing or not knowing, but doing what is not correct.
Okay.
Now this is tamasic karma. Next above that is rajasic.
Mm-hmm.
Now rajasic is like a king.
Mm-hmm.
That means that you are enjoying everything in the material world. Whether it is food, whether it is pleasure, whether it is luxury.
That's very well said. Mm.
It is enjoying everything in the material world. And then you come to the next, which is sattvic. Now sattvic is related to heaven.
Mm-hmm.
So I say I will be good, I will give charity, I will do all the so-called virtuous things in life. Why? Because in heaven, God will give me a reward. That is sattva. Now the Bhagavad Gita further subdivides this. It says, no, it's not only the action. It is the intention with which that action is done, the motive.
Very important. So Mahatma Gandhi talked about that.
This is not the Bhagavad Gita.
Yes, he was also kind of a deep scholar of
Gita,
so he might have taken it from there. He talked about the means and ends. The means are as important or more important than the end.
The end. At the same time, the motive with which an action is done is So now we've got all of these which the Srimad Bhagavad Gita describes as the wombs of pain. That means all your pain originates from this.
The tamasic, the rajasic,
and the sattvic.
And the sattvic.
Surprisingly, sattvic also. Why? Because all of them have an attachment. An attachment to heaven, an attachment to the material world, an attachment to self. They all have an attachment. So they are wounds of pain. Then what is actually your karma? What is the correct understanding there of how do you go above this womb of pain? And that very clearly Lord Krishna tells us is yajna. Now, yajna is the term that is derived from yajna, which means to sacrifice. A sacrificial, they used to have a great collection of people coming there to pray and to sacrifice, and it was all dedicated to God. So yajna is derived from that. So Lord Krishna tells Arjun very clearly, he says, do everything that you are supposed to do. Do the right thing,
duty,
do your duty. But dedicate it to me.
Don't be attached to the reward of, or don't seek some reward.
You've got to step above that.
Even above that, yes.
That this is dedicated to God. Now, that brings us to a very interesting question. I get up in the morning, I brush my teeth. How do I dedicate this to God?
Yeah, something very mundane.
It's a very mundane, day-to-day little thing. And I'm supposed to dedicate even that to God. Why? Because in all scriptures we are told to maintain cleanliness, to maintain our health. So you see how the scripture is so holistic.
That's right.
It encompasses every aspect of you.
Yeah.
So if you dedicate yourself to that and dedicate each action to God, there is no attachment. And if you don't have the attachment, you don't have the womb of pain. You have happiness. You have a spiritual confirmation which adds to your sense of happiness. You have that confirmation that what you are doing is correct, that you are being guided on the right path, and you have dedicated your life to God. So that is one very interesting, simple foundation which is true for all religions.
That's right.
And it is assumed that you know it.
But I don't think it is very easy to practice that. To do something without thinking of a reward or the result of that action is really difficult. But
true.
Maybe when I was thinking of this, the principle of prayer and meditation might be that. Even there you can have a motive. But perhaps in that state of prayer and meditation, you would be detached, or should be detached from the worldly.
I would like to here give you a small story from the time of Baha'u'llah, of one of the Baha'is who was building his house. Now this was the time when if you were known to be a Baha'i, you could be just sort of carried off and killed at any time. All your possessions would be plundered. And here was this Baha'i building a house. And he was putting into that house everything beautiful, very nice. Like one, you would say, I really am putting my heart and soul into building that house. And his colleagues, some of them couldn't understand what is this fellow doing? Doesn't he know that tomorrow this house is going to be plundered? He is not going to have any of it. He is not going to be able to enjoy any of it. Why is he doing this? So finally they couldn't resist it anymore, and so they asked him that, look, what are you doing?
You are not sure of your life.
And here you are building. So you should hear his answer, because it very clearly explains this principle that we are talking about. He says, I am building a house for Baha'u'llah. That means I have dedicated this house to him. Now do you tell me, can I put second-rate material in it? Can I make it not beautiful? Can I make it not perfect? No, it is for Baha'u'llah. So this is what I mean when I say that you dedicate everything to God. Because the moment you do that, you have already put in a basic fact that you are going to be striving for excellence.
So that is why perhaps in the Baha'i faith, there is no ban on wearing the best dresses, living in a good house, or earning your livelihood, and have maintaining best standards as much as you can afford, honestly, because your heart should not be attached to that, those
true
things.
It's like Baha'u'llah said that the world was made for man, but at the same time he's added that it was made for the education of man. So long as we are not attached to the world. And here I am very tempted to tell you another story of a dervish.
Yes, please go ahead.
We all know what a dervish is. It's a person who's renounced the world, he's taking his begging bowl, and he's going around in search of God. And so this dervish, dressed in rags with his begging bowl, thin, lean person, going around, and somebody told him, there's a very spiritual man in the next town. So he says, good, let me go there and let me learn from this spiritual man. And he's asking by name, he reaches the house and he finds that there are two guards at the gate, a palatial house. And he's sort of very timorously, not knowing exactly what to expect, goes to meet the owner of the house. And there is this well-dressed, healthy looking person with the finest of clothes. And he very lovingly welcomes the dervish. And because it was lunchtime, he invites him to the meal, and the finest of foods is laid out. So the dervish very nervously eats whatever, and when the meal is over, this man asks the dervish, now you tell me what you have come for. So he says, I've come to learn more about God. So this rich man says that, yes, this is a very nice thing. You tell me what you want to do. He says, I am out in search of God. Can you accompany me? So this man says, why not? After all, you are going out for a nice thing, let's go. And so this rich man and the dervish, they set out.
He left everything, the rich man.
He just walked out. After they've gone some distance, the dervish says, I have to go back. So this rich man says, why do you have to go back? He says, I left my begging bowl behind. So now this is the concept. Yes, of course it's a story, but it gives a clear concept.
The rich man was not attached to the riches that he
had. The riches he had.
But this guy, he had this small kamandal or begging bowl, and he was so attached to it that he wanted to go and bring it back.
So this state, you see, of not being attached is a state of happiness.
So I think this episode we will bring to an end here. This is the first part, but we will continue it in the second part. So what else can one do to fulfill one's purpose of life in a happy and content manner? Thank you very much, Dr. Rastogi. We look forward to continue this in the next episode.